Today I'm going to be telling you the story of women's safety in Delhi and how it breaks my heart that Delhi is termed as the rape capital of the world. Every day, 6 rapes are reported in Delhi. Recently, I met an 11-month-old baby who was brutally raped in the capital and she had to undergo an operation. Her eyes continue to haunt me. As the chairperson of the Delhi Commission for Women, every day I make it a point to meet rape survivors. It is their pain which gives me the fire in my belly to be able to fight crimes against women in the capital. I wanted to investigate as to why are we termed the rape capital of the world. What is it that we are doing wrong? So I asked for some data from the police. Delhi police denied to give me the data on crimes against women, and they told me that if they give me the data on crimes against women, there will be a law and order problem in the capital. I summoned the police commissioner and I informed him that if he fails to give me the data, which is my statutory right, I will issue arrest warrants against him. I think it was for the first time in the history of India that a woman commission had exercised its powers in this manner. The data came. The data came and it was very shocking. Between 2012 to 2014, 31,446 crimes against women were reported in the capital, out of which less than 150 were convicted. So 31,000 crimes and less than 150 convictions. It is for a fact that people are not scared in Delhi. They feel that they can get away with anything. We have further broken it down into small actionable steps. First and foremost, as the largest democracy of the world, I think it is tragic that our police force is not digitized. Its functioning is not digitized. I think we need to work upon that. For the past 10 years, the center is creating a software for digitizing the police force, but it hasn't seen the light of the day. What does that mean? That means that the police commissioner, the heads of police, they are unable to analyze data right in the morning. Data that should be readily available to them. How many cases were filed? How many cases were redressed? What is the pendency? Which particular police officer is performing well? Which one is not? All that data needs to be made readily available. The other thing is the resources of the police. I have met some very, very fine officers during the course of my duty. I have met officers who are working at the stretch of 48 hours, sometimes even 72 hours. They put in a lot of effort, our police officers. Delhi police for the past 8 years has been demanding 60,000 additional police force, and they have not been provided the same. We are trying right now, we are trying to urge the government to be able to provide them these kind of resources because it is needed. The other thing that we did was we issued a notice to the forensics lab and we learned that out of the 7,500 samples pending investigation, 1,500 had crossed their expiry period. So they could have been putrefied. Who is responsible? Immediate changes need to be made in the system to be able to ensure that forensic samples are tested within a period of maximum 1 month. Apart from that, number of courts, number of judges, we all know that it is painfully less. It needs to be increased. Last year, I met the mother of 2012 gang rape, Nirbhaya. I met her and she said something to me which will stay with me forever. She said that sometimes she feels happy that her daughter is no more. At least she does not have to go through the humiliation of seeking justice, of delayed justice, and sometimes of no justice at all. I think this is what needs to be changed. The story of women's safety is quite tragic. It's tragic because A, it is very, very complex, because there are so many dimensions. There is the state, there's the government, there is the society, there is patriarchy, there are mindsets that need to be changed. At the same time, it is the tragedy of the story is that the stakeholders responsible somehow want it to remain as a complex topic. We don't want to break it down into issues which can be addressed and can be worked upon. It is very difficult to change the system. In 2012, after the gang rape of Nirbhaya, the parliament set up a special task force in the central government, which was supposed to meet 2 times every month. And that special task force was supposed to look into the issues of women's safety in Delhi. It met only 11 times in 3 years. When I questioned that, it was disbanded, and I had to appeal to the High Court to be able to get it reconstituted again. So what presently the Commission and I'm trying to do is, I'm trying to get all these stakeholders to sit down on the same table, let us sit down, let us debate, let us discuss, because at the end of the day, that 11-month-old girl is the daughter of our country, and she needs to be saved. Interestingly, if I look at my story, why is it that I'm fighting? Why is it that I'm trying to change the system? It is because I have a personal stake in this. I have been stared at when I walk on the road. I'm stared at. I have been told many times in my life not to do a particular thing because I'm a girl. I've been told how to sit properly. I've been told how to stand properly. I've been told how not to speak out. And I have been molested. So it's a personal stake, and that is why the fight is on. It's not even so such that it is limited to offline abuse these days. We all know we are in the digital age. Even if I tweet something, or even if any girl who's sitting here, she will tweet something, there will be rape threats, there will be all kinds of abuse. That needs to change. 12 years back, I'm an engineer, I gave up my corporate job, and I decided to do something for the society. I started living in a slum in Delhi, I started working on the grassroots. Back then also, I was laughed at, I was mocked, I was told that a lone girl cannot change the system, and all kinds of horrifying things happened. But I decided to do what I did because I had passion, and I decided that one person can change the world. And I think the years that I spent at the grassroots working for the people's cause has made me what I am today. 2 years back, I became the chairperson of the Delhi Commission for Women. It was very interesting that when I was entering the commission, I was again laughed at, I was again mocked, and I was again told, oh, the women commission, they don't do anything. They are toothless tigers. They cannot achieve anything. They have no powers. Even the last chairperson of the Delhi Commission of Women, she handled only one case in 8 years. What is it that you will be able to achieve? I read the law under which the Delhi Commission for Women was made. And believe you me, the law is very powerful. I can summon, I can issue arrest warrants, I can give recommendations, and I can hold stakeholders accountable. And I started doing just that. In the past 1 year, we have handled 11,696 cases. We have heard 3.16 lakh calls on the 181 helpline. We have made 7,500 grassroots visits. We have assisted sexual assault victims in 5,500 court cases. We have counseled 1,869 sexual assault victims. And we have given 55 recommendations to the different governments on the issue of women's safety. And believe you me, I'm very, very proud to say that Delhi Commission for Women now is the only commission in the country which is even functioning on Saturdays. And unofficially, we are also functioning on Sundays. What makes us different? We are now a part of the system, but what makes us different? We are a government body. We are a government body, but we are challenging the status quo. We are asking questions. We are no longer silent. For instance, a few days back, I decided that we will go and we will visit the shelter homes of Delhi. So we've entered one of the shelter homes run by the government at 8 p.m. in the night, and I was totally shocked to see what I saw. Why I entered in the night? Because I knew as an activist that if I go during the day, there will be officers there and the girls may not feel very comfortable in sharing their ordeal with me in front of the officers. They might get scared. So I entered at 8 p.m. in the night and it was the most shocking moment. The entire night we spent there, we interacted with the women and we realized that most of them have become mentally ill. When I went through the files, I realized that there was no amenities that was being provided to them. And it's my strong apprehension that they became mentally ill due to the torture inflicted by on them in that home. And mind you, these women are not criminals. They were victims of rape, of sexual assaults, of incest, and of trafficking. We created a report on this, a strong report, and the government immediately suspended 5 officers. And that has led the ball rolling. Every now and then we are visiting these homes and we are trying to work with the government to ensure that the shelter homes become a better place. We are also questioning the nexus of the system with the traffickers. Right in the center of Delhi, there is a place called GB Road. GB Road exists at 3 kilometers from the parliament. There are 5,000 women, there are 90 brothels, there are 500 or 600 odd children, and nobody wants to talk about it. It's extremely taboo to talk about it. These women, they are sold from the poorest of the poor places in this country and the nearby countries, and they have to entertain at least 30 men in a day. Sometimes they get some pittance, sometimes they don't even get that much. A police station exists at 100 meters from this road. Every now and then we rescue girls from this road. The latest girl, the last girl that we rescued, was a 15-year-old Nepalese girl who was sold at the age of 9 in GP Road. We rescued her and we learned from her that every day she was made to entertain 30 men without fail every day. And she was given all kinds of injections to make her body look like as if she is a woman. This was happening in the National Capital Territory of Delhi, 100 meters from a police station. The question that we are asking is that how is it that the police doesn't know? How is it that the system doesn't know? For the past 2 years, I have been struggling to get the hidden cells within these brothels demolished. There are hidden cells there. Whenever we go for a raid, the girls are hidden inside those cells and it is very difficult to find them out. Why are they not demolished? Who owns GB Road? Somehow nobody seems to know the answer to that question. Whenever I ask who owns GB Road, who are owning the brothels, they are not coming forward. So we are presently investigating as to who owns GB Road also. Because we broke the culture of silence in commissions, because we asked questions, because we held the high and the mighty accountable, because we are after the traffickers of the multi-million dollar industry which is running in GB Road, the system chose to reward me. In the past 1 year, there have been 2 FIRs registered against me, 2 criminal complaints registered against me by the Delhi police, and presently I'm here out on bail. That is the reward that the system has decided to give to me. One girl, 14-year-old girl, she was raped for 12 days. She was locked up in a room by her perpetrators. She was not given food, she was only given water. And for 12 days, they incessantly raped her. On the last day before releasing her, they gave her acid mixed in a soft drink, which corroded her insides. In all the cases, Delhi police has to inform us in rape cases. In this particular case, they did not inform us. After a month, I want to know about the condition of this girl through a newspaper report. I get angry. I go and visit her and I see her and she's vomiting blood. I get her transferred to one of the best private hospitals in Delhi. I issue a notice to the police officer who failed to make an arrest. I asked him, why is it that you did not inform the commission in this particular case? Why is it that the perpetrator is still roaming free? The next day, the police officer arrested the accused. The very next day, the girl died. And the next day, the same police officer filed an FIR against me saying that I have named the rape victim. It was headlines all over. I never named the rape victim. Of course I will not name her. Why will I name her? I did not name her. Now courts after courts, me and the parents of the victim, We are standing together. They're very poor. Yet they are going on telling the courts that they did not, that I did not do anything. I was the only one who tried to help. But we are being persecuted because we wanted to help. For 4 months, the entire commission, the staff of the commission was denied salary. They had to go to the High Court, and the High Court intervened, and then their salary came. It meant that the entire work of the commission, the 181 helpline, the rape crisis cell, everything was at stake. It could have closed down until the High Court's intervention. I keep hearing in the power corridors, some people, they keep telling me that there was some reference to you. And mostly that reference is around, oh, that girl, that young girl. Now she will tell us how do we have to function. We will teach her a lesson. So it's not just the fact that we are effective, it is also the fact that I'm a girl and we are hurting a lot of male egos within the system. This is what needs to change. I think when we talk about 0 hour and when you talk about one moment that has defined you and that has changed you, I thought a lot about it. What is that one moment? And I think the course of my life gets changed from the moment I come under attack. That's because this attack has what has made me more courageous, more strong, and it has helped me realize my inner potential. What is it that they will do? What can they do to me? What maximum that they can do is they will put me in jail. Even there I will go. There are 600 women in Tihar jail right now. I will go inside Tihar jail. I will create a report for the government. And believe you me, when the moment I will come back, I will ensure that there will be police prison reforms in this country. That is what I'm going to do. It's been 12 years. This journey has not been easy. It's been one of the most difficult journeys. Today, I have no savings because for almost 8 to 9 years in my life, I have only volunteered. I don't have any savings. I have no property. But believe you me, I'm one of the happiest persons on this earth because I have a lot of good wishes from many people. In the end, I just want you to think. I want you to know that this girl, the 11-month-old baby, could have been your baby too. This is everybody's problem. It is not just one problem. This is not a problem which is limited to the state of Delhi. It is beyond states. It is beyond countries. I think the entire world is presently facing this issue where women are suppressed. And I want you to think, I want you to feel angry, feel very, very angry. And please, please, please raise your voice. It is extremely crucial that you raise your voice, you personalize this anger. And until you are able to do that, I don't think things will change. It is the anger of one individual that has the potential to change the world. And we are so many of us. I again request you, please do not think of this as a newspaper story. Do not turn it off. Just internalize the anger. Come out, support the commission, support me, and support all people like me, and raise your voice against abuse. Thank you so much.